Good evening, everybody. Welcome. I figured I would stand in front of the podium since I'm a little short and won't be able to see me. My name is Alyssa Stone. I'm the Senior Director of Programs and Community Engagement here at Mechanics Institute, and I'm so pleased to welcome you all to the San Francisco Opera Summer Season Preview. The very first time, I believe, actually, that San Francisco Opera and Mechanics Institute have had a little partnership like this. So we're very excited, thrilled even, to welcome our special guests. We have General Director Matthew Shilvock, Managing Director of Artistic Gregory Henkel, and Marketing Manager Michael Bragg, who will be our moderator for this evening. And I'll do some brief introductions of them in a moment. For those who might be new here to Mechanics Institute, we are very, very excited to welcome you here. Mechanics Institute was founded in 1854. We're the original nonprofit of the Bay Area, as I like to think of us. We are a cultural center, library, world-renowned chess program, and event center like we're doing this evening. We have author talks, writers groups, cinema on Fridays, and of course our chess tournaments, classes, and scholastic programs, plus all of our fantastic resources in the library like reference classes, lending, and our archives and special collections. If you haven't checked out the library this evening after the event tonight, I highly encourage you to go check out the second and third floors. The library is open until 8 o'clock tonight. Please check out milibrary.org to find out more about our events and programs. We offer many, many things throughout the week, so we hope that you'll join us again soon for another program. With that, I'm excited to introduce our guests for this evening. We have Matthew Shilvock, the Tad and Diane Taub General Director, is San Francisco Opera's seventh General Director, having assumed the role in 2016. Matthew is responsible for all artistic and business aspects of the organization and is passionate about telling profound stories of humanity through the total art form of opera, connecting audiences with the emotional core of the repertoire, and empowering the whole company through a supportive, creative, and fiscally responsible workplace. Gregory Henkel is Managing Director of Artistic at San Francisco Opera, where he oversees repertoire selection, casting, concert programming, and the company's artistic and music planning departments. And San Francisco Opera Center Youth Artist and the San Francisco Opera Youth Artist Training Wing. Gregory conceived of and serves as the executive producer on San Francisco Opera's Webby Award-winning in-song digital programming series of intimate music video portraits, which explore the diverse cultural traditions that inform the personal and musical journeys of some of opera's greatest performers. And Michael Bragg is the marketing manager of digital content for San Francisco Opera. As marketing manager of digital content, Michael oversees all the digital and social media content at San Francisco Opera. He is also a lecturer with the Opera Aficionado series at San Francisco Opera, the JCC, and recently at the Fromm Institute. Please welcome Matthew, Gregory, and Michael.
Hello, everyone. My name is Michael Bragg, and I am so excited to be here to have a conversation with Matthew and Greg. It is a rare treat that we actually get these two in one room to sit and talk about the shows and the wonderful programs that we do at the Opera House. And so I am super excited to be here. I want to give a thank you to Alyssa Stone from the Mechanics Institute to invite us over to have this conversation with all of you here. So we are happy to be here and excited to get this conversation started. So. I think that it would be a wonderful idea. So we're going to be talking about the summer season in particular, but I thought it would be a really wonderful way to get the conversation started is to just talk about the Centennial season as a whole and get these wonderful gentlemen's thoughts and sort of opinions about how that happened and how we got to 100 years and how we created this wonderful season with us. So. My first question to the two of you is, what was the creative process to start this incredible, monumental 100 years celebration of San Francisco Opera? So one of you can decide which one can start. Why don't we start with Matthew?
Well, Thank you, Michael. Good afternoon, good evening, everybody.
It's a real joy to be with you as we prepare to go into the summer part of the Centennial season. So to score for, we opened the Centennial in September, and then we took a little break while the ballet was in over the spring, and now we're about to come back into a pretty frenetic, well, we are back in a pretty frenetic summer season of three operas, a big concert, a wonderful affirmation of the company. And just to take a brief deviation just to know, because we were just downstairs looking at the beautiful map down there of 1854 San Francisco. And just a reminder that opera, there was a huge amount of opera in the city before 1922, when San Francisco Opera did its prototype season at Stanford Football Stadium. And there were a number of different opera houses, many of which burned down along the way. But opera was always a vital part of this city. In fact, I think it was around 1854, if memory serves, that Verdi's Ernani, at least an aria from that, was sung just a few years after it had been written and performed first in Italy. So opera has always been a part of the DNA of the city, and then in 1922 we began the formal company of San Francisco Opera, with the founder, Gaetano Merola, wanting to establish a real world-class destination for singers and a great jewel of the city's cultural crown. So that's where we began. And so, coming into this centennial, we really wanted to showcase where we had come as an organization. It's an organization that has seen some of the history-making moments on stage. Things like Pavarotti's first Turandot, for example, happened here in San Francisco. And so to honor that, but also at the same time to reflect where we're going. And I often sort of say our centennial is a point of arrival, but it's also a stepping off point into our next century. And so we wanted to find the right blend of repertoire between, again, that honoring of the amazing past of the company. And I will just put a plug in, if you want to go deeper after today's conversation, there's a great exhibit that's just opened at the Museo Italo Americano up in Fort Mason area, which I really encourage you to go and take a look at. It's free of charge. It's open through October, and it delves into those early years, including the pre-SFO years. And there's also an exhibit down at Terminal 1 at the airport as well. So lots of ways to get into that past, and some of that season definitely honors and reflects that past. And then other parts of the season reflect a real sense of forward direction, particularly with some very exciting Bay Area composers. Maybe Greg, I'll turn it over to you and kind of talk through what is in this season.
Sure, even the development process, right. I mean, which is an important one. I mean, but normally our planning cycle might be a 4 or 5 year gestation period before we get to the stage. So if you think about, 2022, we go back 4 years, that's 2018, mm-hmm. where we might start these conversations, and it's a pretty daunting task to think about how to honor a company with this legacy, as well as what Matthew was saying is looking towards the future. At that time, we were also in the middle of a music director search, and so we didn't want to get too far ahead of ourselves without having our new music director as part of this conversation of developing what our plans would be for the future. And then in late 2019, we named Eunsoon Kim as our new music director. It was one of the most glorious times of our history and definitely looking towards the future. And there was this huge momentum at the end of 2019 and early 2020. And we had our first, and we were ready to restart the planning conversations, and we knew we were little bit behind, but we had time to catch up. And we had that first meeting on like March 12th, 2020. And we came up with all of these ideas that we're so excited to do. And then 1 week later, lockdown, and the whole world changed. And, we had to put a pin in things as we were trying to survive. So we were trying to figure out what the future would look like and what kind of company can we be. And I'm certainly very proud of the way that we have withstood the tests of the pandemic and thrived during it, came out on the other side, all the while trying to figure out how also to honor this major milestone in our history. And so we had to do this quite quickly and I don't want to say scrappily because it's huge what we did, but maybe mentally and emotionally scrappily.
So like you talked about COVID, did that change some of the decisions
yes.
of what you presented
absolutely
last year?
Yeah.
Year? Okay.
Well, some things we had spots we had left open, and we just didn't have time for them. When could we turn our attention to that? Other things that during the canceled pandemic seasons needed to move around and ended up moving into the Centennial season. But in a way, it all kind of worked out beautifully. I think it's a phenomenal season that does honor so much of what we were wanting to do. And it's amazing that we found our way there regardless. I think it's a testament to all of the members of the San Francisco Opera and as well as Matthew's leadership. That's on track and getting us there.
Right.
I would say if we look at these titles, there were things that meant a lot to Matthew and Timson and I. You know, we have bookended the season with two new operas by Bay Area composers, John Adams' Antony and Cleopatra, and Gabriela Lena Frank's El Último Sueño de Frida y Diego. And that was important to us because, as Matthew was saying, that was an eye to the future, new opera. But also there are two operas in there, La Traviata and Madame Butterfly, which were new legacy productions that were going to last us forever and look at canon, classic titles, beloved titles, in a slightly new lens, in a more maybe modern lens, while still being classic productions that would be beloved by everyone, but with maybe a new understanding of the world. And then two operas, Dialogues of the Carmelites and Die Frau und Schatten, which have their US premieres in San Francisco and they're towering masterpieces of the last century. And that was important, that showed San Francisco Opera's commitment to new opera even at that point, but also, you know, those are masterpieces, and something like Frau und Schatten, you know, is something that rarely gets seen. It's been 30, 35 years since it's been on stage, so that was another reason why it was so important to us. If we could do it now, when would we ever do it? You know, it's one of those bucket list kind of operas. Same thing with Dialogues of the Carmelites.
Yeah. So you mentioned legacy. Matthew, could you tell us about these two legacy and what that means to the company, like what a legacy production is?
Oh, a legacy production, absolutely.
Yes.
So when we put a season together, we this season you see behind us in terms of the mixture of repertoire, it's also a mixture of productions and sources of productions. And the key thing which we're always striving for is balance, whether it's artistic balance, financial balance, visual balance. As a repertory company, we provide a sort of general overview of the repertoire, as opposed to like a festival company, which might, you know, do an entire season focused on one idea or one composer. And so over the course of a season, or because of many seasons, we want to go through a huge amount of repertoire. And so when we put these together, we want to balance things that we create new, so like a new Traviata or a new Orpheus and Eurydice this year, things that we rent from other companies, so we may not have done, as Greg said, like Carmelites and Frau und Schatten. It doesn't make sense for us to build those because we may not do them again for another 30 years. And so we find other companies that have done those, and you kind of go shopping for the things that you think will resonate on our stage. And then there are things that you take out of the warehouse, and then you built it in a prior season, and then you bring back. And the European companies bring back things sometimes once every year, and they cycle through the repertoire very, very quickly. We tend to not bring things back for at least 5 years or so. But there's an interesting kind of fulcrum point for us, because so many of the pieces, the classic pieces, whether it's Mozart's Marriage of Figaro or Tosca or Traviata, they were built at some point between the 80s and early 90s. So they've been coming back sometimes 6-7 times, and they're beloved productions. People have loved seeing these great classic productions. So they have a very high bar in terms of people's expectations of them, but they say, please don't make me see this again. I've seen it 7 times already, but I love it. So what we've been trying to do over the course of the last few years is take this moment to really rebuild the repertory of San Francisco Opera. And so as Greg and I have gone through and looked at the planning, part of that has been with a night really rebuilding our core pieces so that we can give that legacy to the next 30 or 40 years. Because you want those staples in the repertoire, those things that you know that were built for your stage, that work like a glove, so that when you bring in this, literally just arrived yesterday, this 10 shipping container lower room we're doing this fall, which will just completely consume everybody's attention. You know that the thing playing next to it, the trombatore, and it's big again, but we've done it before, we part own it. So you want that blend of productions in there. So building these legacy productions has very much been with an eye to creating something, not just for the moment in time, like this Traviata, but that this Traviata then serving, hopefully, the next 30 years or so. It will be up to whoever's planning 30 years, whether they keep it going or not. But we intentionally design it with that in mind. And we intentionally build it with that in mind. It's actually very specific painting techniques that the scenic painters will use if they know that it's going to be a legacy production. Actually paint it, like you cover the wood with a kind of Hessian or Muslin fabric, and then that gives it another 10 years of life. So there's very special techniques if you're going to do that. If you're doing something for a one-off, you just wouldn't go there. So it's really been kind of a joy to do that.
Well, and I think as Matthew says about balance, I mean, part of that is we have the Madam Butterfly and Traviata are great entry points for new opera goers. And so that was important to us. Dialogues of the Carmelites and Die Frau and Schatten are great for new opera goers, and they have spoken in that way, but they're definitely also really meant for core subscribers who are opera aficionados, and that is going to mean a lot to them. We want to make sure that they know we're still here for them. And it's not just about only new audiences, it's about growing knowledge and experience inside of that. And the role that the new operas play is yet still different than all of that.
Right. So before we move on to the sort of the point of this discussion today, the summer season, when you look back on the fall, what are the sort of proud moments as general director and as artistic director that you're most proud of the fall season? Because the summer obviously hasn't happened yet, so we can't be proud yet.
Works on paper.
Wow. I mean, it's just to have gone through what we did in the fall and to do so in the light of what Greg was talking about in terms of the quick planning cycle, just to add something to that, not even knowing when we went through that, maybe the first year of the pandemic, whether we would even have a centennial. Like it was that questionable because in part because San Francisco was so locked down. And it was only when that vaccine came out that we said, okay, we still don't know if we're gonna have a centennial, but we're gonna go for it. And so to come out of that into this just glorious light of last fall, just the very act of that itself, I think I'm so proud of what the company pulled through to. Because it was also rebuilding the muscles of how we do a big repertory season. You know, usually you do this year in, year out, and it's on autopilot, but you know how it works, and everyone just keeps, repeating but with different titles. This is about relearning how you do all of that work. So even just that act of that was so incredible. I don't know, it's hard to pick specifics within that. I will say the Orpheus and the Eurydice was something which just was a total expression of art. Just from the minute it was conceived, the minute we saw the design presentation, everything just worked so synergistically with that. And then you felt that on the stage as well. I don't know if any of you saw that, but it was just one of those moments where you just felt everything come together, which is what we strive for in everything you do. But that was almost sort of the epitome of how beautifully it can all come together, where you don't know where one art form ends and the other begins, because it's all just a wholeness.
Well, and the thing about that is, thank goodness in a way that we had to wait on knowing everything we did, because Orpheus was the title for this time. We chose it because we realized there was a time where we all had collective grief. The entire world went through years of all sorts of different kinds of grief that we could all relate to. And this opera was about grief. It was a meditation on grief. And so it was a way that, you know, was what we wanted to share with the audience, with this opportunity to look at it in an art form, and then also be able to, one, learn and experience emotionally through that. But I talked to so many people afterwards where they felt like they could speak about grief with other people. They could share it without necessarily having to talk about their own grieving experience, which might have been too much to share, but they could talk about it in general in an open kind of form. And that felt like, oh my God, what would be offered to the city to be able to have something to talk about, even to strangers who were sitting next to you, to be able to talk about grief was something I think was important to have in that moment.
Wonderful. So let's move on to the summer season. And one thing that I particularly, when I look at our titles, which are we're opening with Madame Butterfly, and then we open with Die Frau, Schatten, and then we open with the new work by Gabriela Lena Frank about Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, is that really, in a way, these three operas really do encapsulate almost our entire 100 years. Because Madame Butterfly opened in, 1924, I think was the first time, so that was just a year after we opened as a company. And then in 1959, it was the last time we presented Die Frau und Schatten, but we have a deep, rich history because it was the US premiere. And then we have this incredible new work by a Bay Area native woman, and it's her first Spanish language opera. And so it really does, to me, and correct me if I'm wrong, it really does feel as if these three operas really say, this is 100 years, and this is the next 100 years, because we're always gonna pay homage to the past and our present, and then look to the future. So could you talk maybe about that, if you have any ideas, or if that is your sort of thinking about those three titles in the summer?
Yeah, I mean, I think they each have that role in a way. Again, the Madame Butterfly, a classic production and a very well-beloved opera in a new lens that lends itself to a modern understanding of society.
Which we'll get to.
Frau und Schatten, which we gave the U.S. premiere, and it's not many opera companies can produce Frau und Schatten. It was thought of after its premiere as unproducible. It was so large and so complicated that it was too daunting of a prospect to do it. And it hasn't been performed that often in the United States. I mean, we did it a few times, 59, 64, in the 70s, and then in 89, and it hasn't been seen. But we did it more than any other company in the United States, more than Chicago's done it once, and that was 2007 was the first time I got around to it. And you know, so it kind of showed, it lets us flex, you know, and it shows that we're still doing that. We're still able to do that. We have the resource of talent and energy to still be able to do that and at such a level. So that was important. And then the new opera again, looking forward in the cultural connections and understanding how important it is for representation on our stage to reflect our community and how we can play a role inside of that. But I'd love to hear from you.
Well, it's something you said there, Greg, about the talents of the company. And again, it's one of those things where in the normal course of business, Greg and I have been at the company for many years. Again, the summer seasons are always busy, but you kind of know it's happening. You dig down and you make it happen. Again, this is our first full summer season since 2019. And so I'm reflecting a lot on just how incredulous it is that these three things are happening literally on top of each other. I mean, the casts arrive at the same time pretty much. And the stage is just going to be moving from night to night as we go through these pieces. And as Greg said, with Frau und Schatten, and then as we think about the totality, what it takes for the company to do that, to be moving from these different worlds, these very different oral worlds musically, these different worlds visually, and within just a space of a couple of weeks, basically, to get these shows up and running on top of each other is pretty amazing. And so one of those pieces is, as Greg said, this impossible to produce Frau und Schatten. That's just one of the things. And then these other productions, both of which are new to our stage, which means we're learning how they go. The floor for the new Madame Butterfly arrived from Dresden, and they didn't mark, because it's made up of floor pieces, probably about, 4 feet by 3 feet or something like that. All these pieces have to tessellate together, but Dresden didn't mark the order. It's not just a whole pile of pieces of wood. So they had to spend half a day that they weren't expecting, kind of figuring out how they all fit together. And you don't have time to get off track because everything has to be exquisitely synchronized to that end point.
Right.
So again, just the fact that all of this is happening, this just creative explosion of talent, of this rich content. And again, I think you're right, and I love the analogy of the sort of the early, the middle, and then the present in terms of what these pieces represent. And this new piece, piece by Gabriela Lena Frank and Nilo Cruz, is just this exquisite metaphysical exploration of these two iconic figures who are so well known to us. And people have been going to these exhibits of the De Young and the MoMA and sellout exhibits of these characters. And we're going to be seeing a different side of them, a different interpretation of them through music, through the intersection of music and art. And that's what the opera stage does. It takes these iconic figures and allows us to reflect our own humanity in them. And so that you'll get to see that in three very, very different worlds coming up. And I'll never stop being in awe of walking into that theater. We get the luxury of doing it every day. But to walk into that theater space and, almost overnight, you're in a different world. This is just basically a black box. It's a big black box, and it can do lots of interesting things with lights and projections. But basically, it's make-believe. And every night, we turn this into a completely different world. And the summer season is particularly unique for that because you see it happening just in real time. So I really encourage you to think about, if you're thinking about seeing one, think about seeing a couple, just so you can see that juxtaposition of those different worlds, those different aesthetic worlds, because that's what this kind of company can do that very few other companies can do, not just in America, but in the world.
So thank you. Wonderful. So let's move on. We're going to give a little listen. This is Madame Butterfly. From Madame Butterfly. So let's talk about this this production. So this is a new production to San Francisco Opera, and it's directed by Miyamoto. And so could you just sort of guide us through why this production is so different than what we've done before, and why you chose it? to present in this Centennial season?
I think to start, I mean, Butterfly to me, and it is still about this, even with this new lens. I mean, it's about the promise, the excitement and the promise of new love, but also betrayal and sacrifice, and that is still there at the core of this. But a new lens of what is seen, a concept of this director is that, you know, we start off in the future after the end of Madame Butterfly, and we're at the sort of the deathbed of Lieutenant Pinkerton, and he has an adult son, the little boy that Cho-Cho-san and Inigi had, and he hands a letter to his son, which is essentially a confessional and an apology for, you know, what had happened, and that his son didn't know about his history, his mother, or his multiracial identity. And so it's then the music starts when the son is reading this, and it kind of goes back in time and is witnessing the action that led to his birth and the sacrifice that his mother, you know, gave of her life in order for his future. He didn't know any of this at this time. And so to witness this son watch his parents fall in love, but also the betrayal and loss and his mother's sacrifice is so deeply moving. You know, I always cry at the end of Madame Butterfly. I haven't seen it, but rarely have I cried in Act One, other than having seen in this, because there's even a moment there, Lieutenant Pinkerton, he's kind of crass. He's not a good man, you know. Later, we see at least in this production, he has learned and he's apologizing. He has realized his wrongs to both Cho-Cho-san and to his son. And so, but there's this moment in Act One where he is talking not so kindly about his new wife. And to watch his son read the confession of it and watch him witness it in his imagination was gut-wrenching. Because no son should ever see his father talk about his mother in that way. And so to see it in this lens was something I had never seen on stage for Madame Butterfly. And that was very different, as well as Butterfly's entrance, which is always beautiful. But for this young man to, this is the first time he's seen her. It's an imagination of her, but he didn't know she existed. That was never shared with him. So he drops to his knees just in awe of seeing his mother for the first time. And so it just cuts very differently than most Madame Butterflies, but it's still the story of Madame Butterfly. There is no change in the plot or anything like that. There is just some new action that is added into it that doesn't affect where we begin or end, right? But it just adds another lens to it that I find extremely moving.
Did you have anything to say, Matthew?
I mean, great. Outlined it beautifully there. This bottom photo down here on the right-hand side is the two troubles. So the trouble is the name of the little boy, as Greg said, the offspring of Pinkerton and Cho-Cho-San. And through the entire opera, his older self, his 30-year-old self, is on stage the whole time witnessing this unfolding. And there are these moments where, you know, oftentimes he's off to the side, you know, he's very much the observer. And there are times where he gets close into the action. And this is one of them where he's actually interacting with his former self, with his young self. And there's great, like, there's just moments where the waterworks just come up because it just adds to that layer of someone connecting with their own identity and learning about their own identity, what made them who they are, and this idea that he's discovering this. And as you move into the end of the opera, and I was just talking to the director about this the other day, it's both he's reading this, and of course, when the beginning of the story doesn't even exist because he hasn't been born yet, his parents have only just met. But by the end, you know, as this four-year-old boy, he's now beginning to unlock his own memory. So it's this beautiful kind of moment where that it's the reading of this letter is actually unlocking something in himself as well. And as Greg said, it's exactly the same story. It's told very traditionally, beautiful kimonos by Japanese fashion designer Kenzo Takada. I mean, you will look at this butterfly and you'll feel it's a very, in some ways, a very traditional butterfly, but it's almost like you move the nature of the storyteller to someone else in the drama. And it's amazing how powerful it is. But yeah, that's a bottom photo. There's a good reflection of that.
Wonderful. Let's move on. So, Die Frau, ohne Schatten, let's give a little listen. You said flex. You said, you know, when you do, when a company does a Die Frau and Schatten, produces a Die Frau and Schatten, they're kind of flexing. And one of the things that you can, you're flexing is this, just merely the size of the orchestra. Because it is orchestrated, he orchestrated it for over 160-piece orchestra, which actually no company can ever do because they don't have the money. They bankrupt themselves. But we here at San Francisco Opera are pretty close. We've gotten pretty close. Can you talk about just other ways that we flex in this opera, and also just the significance of the production that we're doing?
I mean, I'll just start. I mean, it's a cast of a million people as well, besides like how many in the orchestra. I can't even keep track of how many people are involved, but you have to have five of like the greatest singers in the world around, and to get them all there at the same time, it's not an easy thing. And we do have that with Johann Reuter and Nina Stemma and Camilla Nylund and David Buckphillip and Donald Ronicles conducting. I mean, you need to, the stars need to align, plus so many other small roles that are so difficult to sing and musically challenging.
I will say this, that is to this man's, like, This is the guy who made all that happen. So we should give him a round of applause. Because the most part of it is to make those stars alive. Let me tell you something. He made them alive.
Thank you for knowing that. I think that's a big part of it. And I'll hand over the sort of production significance to Matthew.
This is one of those ones where actually the pandemic had an influence on how, because we knew that this was going to be one of the tentpoles of the Centennial. This, as Greg said, this was honoring the past of the company as always being innovative because we did the premiere in the US. And there were a number of productions, there aren't that many productions in the world of Frau Schatten, again, it's very rarely produced. And when you go out to look at them, you're looking at what's available, what fits, what's technically possible, what's available. And some of the productions we looked at early on were just too big. They needed sort of technical elements we didn't have. There were a couple actually we were kind of looking at seriously, which actually never then happened because of the pandemic. So there were a couple we were talking to, and they had to postpone for years and years before they could recapture this piece. Actually, we ended up with something which I think actually is a really beautiful expression for the Centennial, which is this production by David Hockney. And then David Hockney has had this very, very deep relationship with the company. We've done, I think, four of his other productions. His Turandot is one that we have seen many times on our stage. Just these bold expressions of color and shape and light. He has gone deep in every production he has done. He has gone deep into the characterization. He'd have a little model in the studio, and he'd spend hours like moving characters around, shining lights, and trying to get just the right color. So he's someone who thinks a lot about the intersection of music and the visual. And this production is in this just fantastical world where these deep, bold colors, these sweeps of architectural shapes. The story is very mythic. It's very sort of transcendental. And one of those stories where you want to focus on the big picture, but not the details, because the big picture is all about who we are and how we go through life and the decisions we make. It's a very complex story if you read the synopsis, but it's one where you want to zoom out and think big picture. And as you heard in the music there, that's always very much in the musical language. And I think in this hockey production, it's going to be in the visual language as well. But again, sort of to be honoring one of those great visionaries of the artists who have been on our stage so many times, I think that's just a wonderful thing to be doing in the Centennial as well.
Wonderful. Let's move on. So the next show that we're doing is the new premiere of El Último Sueño de Frida y Diego by Gabriela Lena Frank and Lila Cruz. And so let's give a little listen. Now, we can't give you any, we don't want to give any of the music away. We want you all to go see the show. So go get your tickets today to see the show. But we are going to play something that LA Opera, during the pandemic times, had a digital series. And so they commissioned Gabriela Lena Frank to write a little short opera for them as part of their digital series. And it was all about Garcia Lorca. And so here's a little segment of that, just to give you an idea about her music. Spanish language opera on our stage in 100 years, and what was those, how did that come to be?
Well, I think, again, this is something where the stars aligned differently because of the pandemic. We had been interested in Gabriela as a composer. She's someone who's had a deep presence in the symphonic world. She's been the composer in residence. She's at the moment with the Philadelphia Orchestra, and has been with Houston, and Detroit. So someone whose music is very well respected on the symphonic stage, but has not really done opera until this point. And we heard about this piece that it had a very long gestation period before it found its first performance last fall in San Diego. And the timing pre-pandemic just wasn't going to work out. But we'd already begun talking about, is there something else we could do with it? And then when everything got thrown up in the air and the pieces fell down after the pandemic, it turned out that we could be a part of it. And so we joined it as a co-commissioner. And again, I think the beautiful intersection here of Gabriela as a Bay Area composer. She was born in Berkeley. She now lives in Boonville, where she has a kind of artist academy up there. And she thinks very deeply about place and the intersection of place and music and culture. She's someone who has a very broad perspective of the world. And language is very important to her. She has an amazingly sort of diverse background herself in terms of her parents. And the very deep naturalness of this piece with this Cuban-American, Roberta Stephen Cruz, and I think the manifestation of text and music and language comes together beautifully in this. And do you think Greg is just...
It's, you know, you had said the story is metaphysical, and it is, and so is the music. It's so atmospheric. Yet you can tell how lyric it is as well. And as you talk about time and place and how music interacts with it, that really encapsulates her style of thinking about making music and what is there. And I think, you know, even pre-pandemic, we had been looking at and thinking about where we came from and where we went ahead to. We thought about our founding and, you know, knew in many ways this we were a company founded by immigrants who wanted to see their music from their culture out on stage. This big Italian opera at that time. Now, what are the other cultures who are now living in the Bay Area, and how can we be here for them as well, where they can see themselves represented as part of, you know, the entire balance of beautiful art that we put on stage? And so we have been looking about how to create more collaborations across culturally, and this seemed like a perfect one, with many tie-ins to San Francisco. You know, it was Diego Rivera's first mural was here in San Francisco, I think at Koi Tower, which is still there. San Francisco was Frida Kahlo's first visit to the United States. They were remarried at City Hall, just across the street from the Opera House. They had works that were hung in the Museum of Modern Art, which is a space that we inhabit now across the courtyard in the Veterans Building. So there are deep ties to San Francisco that we felt, you know, was important to embrace and be part of telling this story.
And when you do a piece that is outside of the traditional canon, it gives us the opportunity to engage differently, both inside the opera house and outside the opera house as well. So for example, as we did with Dream in the Red Chamber a few years ago, with this that was a Chinese opera, we had Chinese supertitles. For this one, we'll have both English and Spanish supertitles in the opera house, which again, these are divergences from us, which are amazing in terms of inviting new people in, making this a building and a cultural institution that hopefully people will consider to be their own in the city. And we'll see that as we go into the coming season as well with new works. And so as we broaden the storytelling of who we are as an organization, hopefully more and more people will just see this as a place where they can feel at home. So I think with Frida and Diego, that's our deep hope, is that there will be people who come to this building for the first time and have the kind of awe of what is possible for these stories.
Thank you. And then last but not least, we're going to talk about the 100th anniversary concert. So there was not enough to put everyone's name up there, because there are 3 world-renowned conductors and 15 opera stars. So again, if you haven't gotten your tickets, please go get your tickets, because this is truly a once-in-a-lifetime thing. You're never going to see this many stars on one stage. Could you talk about just sort of how this sort of concert came to be and like what it represents as far as like the centennial season?
Well, I mean, I'm going to flip this to Greg, because that kind of echoes something that Michael said earlier, which is Greg's an extraordinary mastermind in bringing together artists, and does so beautifully on the stage with individual operas. But in a concert like this, is taking that to a whole new level, both finally curating who's going to be attending, the pieces that they're going to be singing, to express a story, to express the story of the company. It's not just finding, you know, who's available and what can they sing and Greg, you're done. It's such a detailed expression that Greg's been putting together for months and months now of this. So Greg, please, first of all, thank you for reflecting the company in this way, and please share how you came to this assembly.
I mean, again, another daunting task of one night only, you know, trying to represent and honor 100 years of history. And there are so many ways to think about it. And, you know, I didn't want to lose sight of 100 years and how many aspects that come into making opera. It's not only about the singers. It's not only about the orchestra. It's not only about the production. It's about all of those things together. And people, you know, you could honor some great luminaries who are still with us today, but then you're ignoring people from those earliest seasons, like Kirsten Flagstad and Laurence Melchior. So what what I decided to do was kind of find a way to honor all of that, looking through every style of music making we've been a part of, every repertory game. So you've got your Verdi, you've got your Wagner, but you've got American musical theater, which we have a history of. We've got new music that we are a part of. We've got early music like Monteverdi, but also Handel and Mozart, Verismo, and everything in between. But I wanted it really to be like the biggest, grandest moments of opera, but also the most intimate moments of opera back and forth. So, and to have all of that with performed by our most beloved stars throughout. So it's a meaty program, but I think it's something that they're just, you don't have to think a lot about it, even the stuff that you might not have ever heard, because it's full of energy and it's going to be driving us to the end.
Well, thank you so much. I think we're right at time to sort of take some questions. So if anyone has any questions,
I will come around with the mic,
okay,
and we'll try to get to as many questions as we can. We'll start here.
Juicy at the back.
I'm Wilma Minus. I'm the historian of the Diego Rivera mural that's currently at MoMA, and I encourage everybody to go out and see it. It may only be there for another 6 months. It's a masterpiece. It's free, and the San Francisco Opera, Gabriela and Nilo and Omaha Opera have already booked me for tours, and I got tickets for 3 different performances of the Último Sueño that Frida y Diego, and I encourage people to go and see it more than once, but get over and see the mural.
Fantastic.
Thank
you.
Introduce yourself. Your name?
Will Minus.
Well, and I just want to say, Will, as Greg said earlier, the connections here are deep within the city. You will know them much better than us. But the connections within the piece as well, the director of this, Lorena Maza, actually grew up with, as best friends with Diego Rivera's grandson, Juan. And she would be doing her homework in Diego Rivera's studio before it became a museum, and like just surrounded by his artwork. And to feel her connection to him, she knows some of Frida Kahlo's cousins, is just extraordinary. And so again, it's one of those pieces where you just feel like the layer upon layer building. And again, the fact that we have these beautiful murals in the city, I hope that people will see it holistically in that way.
I see a hand up in the front here.
The new concept for the butterfly, are you able to do that with the original score, or do you have to supplement the score to support the score?
Same score. And in fact, so we start with what is, you know, a theatrical term called the dumb show, which is just acting in silence. And so there's no added music. And then sort of during the Act 3 prelude, rather than it being just a curtain coming in, there is action that happens over it in the other part of the stage, but it's all Puccini's music, nothing added, nothing subtracted.
Excuse me if this is a little bit off topic, but I, you know, after hearing about the wonderful season you have planned for the I'm kind of like wanting to go to all the operas. On the other hand, I do have a budget, and one thing that's been a problem for the in the past, the reason why I've been to San Francisco Opera in at least a year, is, you know, to buy rush tickets, I was told that I'd have to buy them the day before, which doesn't work for me. And I'm wondering, to make opera more accessible for those of us over 65 who have, you know, limited incomes, whether you're going to liberalize the rush ticket policy to make it easier for us to buy tickets the day of performance.
Well, we've done with this new program, which is a little different from Rush, called the Dolby Tickets. And I don't know if any of you have heard of this program, but it's a really extraordinary program we've launched this season. And it's available if you haven't been to the opera in the last 3 years, so I'm not sure if you would qualify for that or not. But basically every single performance, we have at least 100 tickets for $10 each in good parts of the house, not just up in the guards. And we put them on sale a month before the opera opens. So we did already this summer, last week we did Madame Butterfly, which opens on June 3rd, and we did Frau und Schatten, which opens on June 4th. But I guess, where are we? That day is today.
The
11th. So on Saturday, we're doing the Dolby tickets for Frida and Diego. And so, but I encourage you, if you can take advantage of those, if you live in the Bay Area, you haven't been for the last 3 years, you can sign up for those, but they are going literally within hours. So if you go to the opera's website, you can see the links to that. And it's been amazing. We've seen 70% of the people who have had tickets are brand new to the company. And so these people who are just exploring the company for the very first time, and many of them have already bought a second ticket for the same season. So it's not quite rush. We still do have rush, but we are generally trying to do these programs now earlier on so that we can kind of build the energy and excitement. So it becomes a layer of different programs, including rush, but now these other programs which are bringing new people in as well. But an important reminder, I mean, tickets for the opera do begin as, make sure I get it right, it's maybe $27 or so.
$26.
So there are always, you know, tickets at that price point as well for the opera. So hopefully it's something where people can feel energized to come in at many, many different price points. Anyone else?
And just a reminder, our Mechanics Institute community was gifted a discount code summertime for 25% off of tickets as well. So that 26 becomes 20 something. Any other questions?
Well, thank you so much, Matthew and Greg, for taking this time to chat with us about the season. I hope that we will see all of your beautiful faces at the Opera House this summer, and continuing in the fall. So thank you so much. Thank you to the Mechanics Institute, and have a wonderful week.
Our special guests, Matthew, Greg, and Michael, join us here at Mechanics Institute. Thank you all for coming. Definitely check out milibrary.org for events that are coming up. And of course, check out sfopera.com to see all the incredible programming that they have coming up this season, over the summer. The big concert date is what day again?
June
16th. So definitely make sure to check out that incredible, incredible concert, and see you all at the opera.
I'm going to go to the next one.